This is a lecture on the High Renaissance given by Anthony Caradonna at Pratt Institute School of Architecture. It was for the first year history survey given in spring 2015. It's the second of two parts. The first part is on the early Renaissance, which will be posted later. This one is on the High Renaissance.
Okay, good morning. As we all settle in, I'm going to start because this lecture will be a bit long, or condensed, and hopefully not long, longer than 2 hours allotted. So last week, just a reminder, we began with the transition back into European architectural history, starting with the Renaissance and humanist culture and the rebirth of classical culture and antiquity and the beginning of humanism. And this week we continue with the High Renaissance. Last week we started with the early Renaissance of Brunelleschi and Alberti and an introduction to the tenets of the Renaissance, the cultural context, and the grounding intellectual and creative of humanism. So today we'll begin directly with Bramante, who was a very important figure. He began, as we see in the Renaissance, architects begin sometimes from one or two experiences, and somehow those become founding experiences that lead them somehow into architecture. Same is true with Bramante. Bramante is a very important figure. Like many people in his position, he's also lucky to have been born at a time where the architects before his generation brought new ideas into context, and he was lucky enough to have that hindsight and then advance it. So we'll see that he's somebody who's a real synthesizer of these experiments that the early Renaissance architects began bringing in Roman and classical antiquity and iconography and architectural elements and systems, as well as ideas that are found, as we saw from Petrarch and others, this reinvigoration of classical culture, classical literature, classical philosophy that had been somehow hidden away from the cultural eye and the cultural context in monasteries where that information was stored or rewritten. And this information starts to become revalued. And so these ancient models become Renaissance models and theories, or develop into Renaissance models and theories. And so Bramante is somebody who kind of reaffirms this and takes further and tests more these ancient and humanist theories and principles, looking at the architects of his previous generation and antiquity, and creates a kind of universal approach, a synthetic approach that's adaptable. He takes the classical architectural grammar and makes it somehow malleable, more organic, more flexible, and expands ways that some of the techniques, older and invented, can be readapted to new possibilities. He also somebody very much involved with in being of the second generation of the Renaissance, very clear command of perspectival abilities, meaning seeing things in perspective, drawing the world in perspective. And most artists by this point, remember, we're like 40 years beyond Brunelleschi and Alberti already. So understanding perspective and how to see the world and how to construct space and envision and conceive of space and imagery through a perspectival frame is by now a norm, and Bramante is an expert at this. So this kind of ability arises through Bramante and others of this kind of organic spatial expression, that interior space, again, like in Roman architecture, becomes a kind of primary element of architecture, but how it's expressed both as an interior and on the exterior buildings is something we'll see developed much more strongly in Bramante. So he defines space, again, as an object of art, as something to be appreciated, as opposed to the surface or the object or the mass. And he'll also, and later on, when he gets to Rome, as we'll see, and in his more mature time, he will also, like Alberti, try to bring this kind of monumental importance, this monumental scale and complexity of architecture back into a kind of presence, both not only in Rome but in architecture in general, and we'll see that, and we'll see how Rome becomes a real important context for this and a testing ground for this approach and this initiative. So we'll see much more complex, large-scale urban and garden designs, both with Bramante and with Michelangelo. And both Bramante and Michelangelo will create sort of new sort of a challenge or testing ground or precedence models for later architects, like which will become the Mannerist and the Baroque era and Baroque artists, to sort of develop further and to be inspired by and to pick up the challenge and the torch and move forward and develop architecture as part of and in the context of the shifting culture that becomes more and more secular, more and more scientific, more and more modern in our sense of the word. Okay, so there's the background. Okay, so who is Bramante? Bramante, as we see, was born in 1444. The dates here are questionable, but so he's about 30 years old when we're looking at these examples, but he's a person who comes from Urbino. Urbino is in the sort of Middle East part of the peninsula of Italy, a very important place right next to Tuscany. Tuscany's on the left side of Italy. Sorry, I don't have a map. Today, geography is a little less important because the peninsula of Italy, especially Middle Italy, will become a very important creative ground. Tuscany, Urbino, and Rome will be important centers, as well as the north and Milan. And we find in Urbino the court of Federico de Montefeltro. This is the guy down at the bottom here. This is part of his wedding portrait. The other half is his wife, which was on another panel. But we see he's an interesting figure. Federico de Montefeltro is a kind of, he's actually a military genius, a military strategist, who works and has his own army for hire. Again, a kind of Renaissance development that independent, wealthy, skilled person, intellectually or otherwise, in this case a military leader, is considered an expert and hired by different states, different fiefdoms, different Italian states when they need to go to war. So he masses quite a big reputation as well as quite a big bank account from being so good at what he does. I wish I could get into the stories of some of the interesting intrigue that he was involved with, especially in the Renaissance and the Medicis, but that's another class. In any case, he becomes one of these many models of Renaissance princes who are not only great at what they do as business people or as leaders in the society, but then they also cultivate their own sort of court, which is comprised of intellectuals and artists, the most current intellectuals and artists, and turn their palace, their house, their palazzo, into a kind of a think tank, into a kind of collection, as well as a kind of patronage for artists, for scientists, for mathematicians, for writers. And so in that process, not only they educate themselves, but also show their status as kind of prominent people in the society, not just in their own endeavors professionally, but as cultivated people. And so each of these princes, and at this time, we'll talk about this rejuvenation of the Otium heritage and tradition of Roman society, where you know the country and the house is the place where one goes away from doing work and revives oneself and rejuvenates oneself and rests, and also has a kind of refuge from the world where one can study literature, can become cultivated in other ways. And so what we see on the bottom right are the cabinets in the palace of Federico de Montefeltro, mm-hmm. which are basically wood inlays or intarsios, which, as you can see, all depict these very highly developed Renaissance tenets of pictorial construction as well as architecture. We see in the middle panel a great example of Roman, an understanding of Roman, the Roman orders and Greek and Roman orders applied to arcaded and colonnaded systems that are depicted on each of these panels. Each of these panels depict what perhaps is hidden in the panels, which are books, manuscripts, handwritten manuscripts of great texts that only wealthy people can afford, that mostly only wealthy people are educated and able to read. And so this, in this cabinet, it seems very big, but it's probably the size of this bay here, but maybe a little bit bigger, between the column and the corner. It's a very small room, but in there is, next to his bedroom, is Federico de Montefeltro's private library. And these cabinets are designed and executed by many artists. We believe that some of these cabinets were maybe laid out with, by, or assisted by Bramante, because Bramante was from Urbino and worked in the court. And Raphael, who's another name of a famous artist who will come up shortly, and I think in Ed's lecture much more clearly and strongly on mannerism. And so Bramante begins by working closely with the great artists who are working in this court, assisting and learning how to be a perspectivalist. That means somebody who draws and can paint, draw, set up, design scenes in perspective. And this drawing here is an interesting one. Here we see the most prominent artist of the time from that area, Piero della Francesca, there was a question at one time whether that painting was actually by him, but it's been confirmed again that it is by Piero della Francesca, this kind of early and developing Renaissance master of Renaissance painting. And we see all of those conditions we talked about last week that we find arising in art, the use of classical antiquity and a kind of more accurate and scholarly way of depicting the orders and all the elements of Roman architecture as the kind of state of the art of architecture within painting, and also this very sophisticated and clearly precise ability to construct and see and depict the world in perspective. This, of course, is a scene of Christ's flagellation from the New Testament, and in the foreground, series of figures which perhaps are symbolic or may be part of the people who are the patrons for some of the court that contributed to this painting. It's always a mystery. It's not quite clear what all these elements are. On purpose, there are symbols that even today we don't know how to look at paintings anymore from the Renaissance. There's a kind of iconography and a syntax to reading all of these images and the symbols behind them. It's from a different culture. This is sort of the height of painting at the time. And Bramante is right around in this hotbed. And we see something that has been attributed to him, this kind of guard, this kind of courtyard drawing or painting of a scene of a man who's miraculously wounded by a stake but isn't killed. That's the sort of scene. But the framework in the background is this courtyard, this decorated and garlanded courtyard, probably during a festival, and beyond that portal, this domed building. And so we look at this as important because this, if in fact this was Bramante and Soli Bramante's drawing, we see a kind of reconstruction of the plan and this elevation or section elevation through this scene. So this is the courtyard and this is what the proposed dome is behind from the clues of the architecture, being able to be deconstructed and reconstructed in perspective and in plan and section. And we see a circular tholos or a circular domed religious building. And we see this kind of courtyard space. Interesting because we'll see that Bramante later on will pick up these themes over and over again in his own architecture. So he begins as a perspectivalist and a painter, and eventually he has to move out because as an artist, artists are basically freelance artists working on their own, looking for patronage around the courts of Italy, the different states of Italy, until they can find, you know, a strong patronage, one very strong patron, and of course, Bramante, being a brilliant artist, does find one, probably the best patron you could find at the time, the Pope. But we'll get to that in a minute. So on his way to looking for commissions, he moves north to Milan, where a lot of artists are working on the famous Milan Cathedral, which I showed you last week, where he rubs shoulders with many artists, including Leonardo da Vinci, who also is working on this project at the time. And along the way, he gets his first important commission, which is this renovation and expansion of this, see the plan here on the upper left, of this church called Santa Maria Presso San Satiro. And it's this kind of elongated hall, which is not quite a church. It's this hall connected to another kind of chapel. And he's given the commission to expand it in this kind of tight and limited site. And you'll see that both these architects are very good. In some way, they seek these kind of difficult, tight problems that they have to work their way out of with their ingenuity, with their artistic creativity and their way to invent using the techniques and their own that they've learned and the powers that they have of their own personal ability and talent, and do very magnificent things with very little and very tight constraints. So this church is in a kind of a tight site, so he can't quite rebuild the church, but he wants to do, all these artists and architects have this ambition to create this ideal setting, this ideal architecture based on not only Roman models, but these Renaissance tenets, including a kind of circular or centralized church or temple. Okay, so he attempts this, and he's very good at it. In fact, we might see some of the residue or reminders of San Andrea in Mantova that we saw last week, which was the last church we saw by Alberti. And in fact, there's a very close visual relationship to it. In fact, Bramante knew about that project. And we see here a few things. One that's really ingenious is, first of all, not only does he expand the church, so he reorients the church and makes a kind of cross out of the plan, which is ideal or sort of preferred. But he doesn't have as much room to play with the space as he'd like to. One, to create a centralized church, but also to create this kind of expansive space of Roman architecture of the scale that we saw last week in San Andrea in Mantua, which is a very, very big church. Okay, this is a very small church. It's hard to show the scale here, but we can see even from the scale of the exterior, which is taken from over here, it's a quite small structure, very low. But the perception is that it's very grand and big from the images I show you. One, he introduces and redecorates a dome at the crossing, which is now the crossing of the plan. But he also does something very wonderful, which both painters and theater designers by now are very well practiced, using perspective to make a space seem bigger. But if we look at the plan, this space that we see here, right, looks like it's very deep. Looks like it could be at least 10 or 20 feet deep. It's actually not even a meter deep. It's a meter and a half deep. It's a little bit deeper than that column, maybe double. And we see how sophisticated Bramante is at creating this false perspective in this shallow space, showing something, a space that seems to be a long vaulted Roman coffered space behind or just over the altar, which is just beyond the semicircular dome, spherical pendentives and arches sitting on piers, which we've seen before, right? In our Roman architecture, Hagia Sophia, and also in Brunelleschi's projects, as well as in Alberti's projects. And here we see it again, but it's quite, you know, a feat to create this kind of theatrical, almost cinematographic kind of space. And again, we see how quickly he's mastered the idea and also the sort of techniques of understanding and being scholarly aware of how Roman architecture must have looked from the examples that he's looking at, both Roman and early Renaissance architects like Alberti. And it's a kind of tour de force, his first major project, and shows how brilliant he is and how skillful he is. And he finally gets a kind of full-scale commission. Really, it's just a piece of a building, but it is a freestanding building, another project in Milan. Clearly, in Milan, there are commissions, therefore there must be patrons, there must be money. So there are a lot of artists working in this area of Milan, which has close ties to France. And we see on the inside, he adds this again, this crossing and this, what he couldn't build physically in the previous project, we see in this new project, this extended apse behind the altar. So he has a chance to create a kind of piece that is like a centralized church, right? The dome is the center, the transepts and the apses on the sides of the dome and the extended apse of the altar become a kind of ensemble or a set of pieces, a set of volumes that express this kind of centralized ideal of a Renaissance church, but it's attached to this very medieval structure, which has all of these X's in the ceiling, which means these are cross vaults. They're not Roman vaults, they're more like Gothic vaults. And some of the things that Bramante does, let's list them first and look at them. We see the interior is quite different, especially in the decoration. No longer is it really truly Roman. It's not really trying to be completely Roman. It's still using some of the same proportional and decorative devices we might find in Roman buildings, but are really, in many of the cases on the surface, these are very inventive, very Bramantesque kind of inventions. And so, going from the larger to the smaller, we spoke about those apses that sort of expand and inflate the space from the center of the dome. The dome is actually very, very interesting, although I don't have a great shot of it. It has this kind of alternating rib-like quality, which also is reminiscent of Brunelleschi's old sacristy that I showed briefly last week, we'll see again today, and that there's a window and a rib and a window and a rib, like a kind of an umbrella vault, but it's much lighter in overall experience because look how white it is, white and gray. There's a kind of uniform quality to it. There isn't this kind of tessellated color or tessellated design that detracts from seeing the overall. The circle as a kind of emblem, a very important geometry in the Renaissance, becomes this kind of module at different scales. We saw that module, Alberti using that in his first church commission, but really as a kind of proportional logic that you don't see on the surface. Here, Bramante is actually using it as an emblem, as an icon, and creates this quite interesting patterned surface condition of circles and circle organizations, identifying both the dome, the arches, and the different fan shapes of the vaults and the semi-vaults to create this kind of very visual flickering effect. And the light that comes in, that illuminates and brightens this kind of contrast, helps to lighten this kind of feeling of the architecture, which is much less heavy and is more about this, brings more attention to the space rather than the surface. Okay, so he's moving ahead here, and so we get this kind of spatial reading, We get this reading of the building as an organism, especially when we see Bramante expressing, and again, using examples from Roman architecture, expressing through these apses and through the rising dome, this sense that the building is kind of inflating, right? The space is pushing out, and the outward forms of the building also sort of express what's on the inside, these shapes, these forms, these volumes. And we'll see how other architects do that. We see that on the exterior, he's not quite as successful. He hasn't figured out. And Bramante, by the way, is not as successful in sort of building exteriors as he is on the surfaces of the interiors. We'll see examples of that. And this, again, is a kind of byproduct of the development of Renaissance architecture. We'll have to wait for Michelangelo and others to sort of bring that to the fore. He's still using some techniques that are, you know, reminiscent of earlier architecture, pre-Renaissance architecture. And the kind of patterning of elements seems like they're kind of collaged together. There is no sense of the overall, but the effect here of these inflated volumes, this organic quality of the volume being expressed both on the exterior and the interior is clear and successful. And we just, I spoke about how those details of the surfaces define the surface and kind of make it more uniform, unified, and how the light brings it all together so that the whole is not dominated by the detail. In fact, the detail helps to express the kind of continuity. And so in this way, art, you know, reading the building, there's a new kind of sort of syntax, a new kind of language for reading what architecture is, what the building is from these elements and the way he uses them. Okay. Just as a side story, in the plan here, this space here, if none of you know that, you probably know that the Last Supper is painted right on this wall, which is the refectory, which is where, next to this cloister, the study cloister, where the priests who are living in this complex and serve the Mass have their dinner or their meals. And so that's sitting right above here. And this is where Leonardo's Last Supper is depicted and still exists in its ruinous state, like most of his paintings, all in ruinous states. We'll talk about that briefly. But so he rubs elbows with Leonardo da Vinci, probably has conversations. They probably they're recorded to being very respectful of each other. And at that time, we can see similar studies in Leonardo da Vinci's sketchbooks around the time when he's in Milan, also working on the cathedral. These studies for these kind of, let's say they call them mechanism, a kind of kit of parts of different volumes, which some of which are based on Byzantine models, like the nine square Byzantine plan, attempts to create a catalog of opportunities, of possibilities for ways that these circular elements can be organized into centralized, idealized churches, fully three-dimensionally realized. Again, we see a very close relationship to the last project we saw. Probably these sketches and conversations with Leonardo contributed to that design. And so that's kind of something that obsesses these architects. Now, at this point, Bramante has kind of filled his pockets with commissions. He's got his own independent means to sort of move around and take his time and not run from commission to commission. And he decides to go to Rome to spend a couple of years to really study, like many architects do at the time, the great monuments, to measure them, to study them. He's very much more interested in architecture, moving from only being a painter to somebody clearly dedicated to architecture and interior design. Although it was never called interior design back then. And we see his very interesting first commission. And again, the first commissions in Rome, again, are really tight. They're very difficult. They're small projects. So he has to focus and place the agenda for what he will define as the kind of commission intervention in very specific terms. And it gives him also the opportunity to sort of edit down, right? To sort of focus clearly on how to construct a kind of argument about architecture. And clearly here, again, we've heard this already and we see a similarity to Alberti. His sort of clear, more strong development of the understanding of the proportions of an existing building. This is Santa Maria della Pace, a very important building. Many architects worked on this. This second version of the building, which is built on the foundations of an earlier building, is constructed in the 1480s, so it's only about a 10-year-old project by the time Bramante is commissioned to renovate the courtyard, again, the cloister, next to the church where the priests live and where their offices are. And later on, this is a much later addition in the 1600s by Pietro della Cortona, but many architects work on chapels in here, including Raphael, after Bramante. So Bramante sort of begins to help set the tone for how important this church, this site will be for architecture and its kind of experimental development. But he does something very, in a way, unlike himself to date, which is, but perhaps very much embedded in his court sort of mathematical and scientific knowledge of perspective, his expertise in that. And so he begins to look at both the proportion systems, as Alberti would have, and the true sort of resolution of this Roman architectural language into a system that can be applied to buildings and conditions which they were not originally intended to be. So we see in this space, and let's look at that first, the bottom left is probably a good place to start. We see the overall space, we see the sort of octagonal or hexagonal, forget if it's octagonal or hexagonal, let me count the sides, one, two, three, and it's hexagonal. Hexagonal base of the sort of vaulted dome of the church beyond, and we see cross on the left where you enter. You don't enter, and interestingly enough, there's an organizational symmetry here, but there isn't an experiential symmetry, right? You don't enter at the center, you enter at the edge, off center. The centers are occupied by columns, and so the overall effect, first of all, is that the architecture is looking back at the space. It's a courtyard design. It's really, again, a facade design, which is kind of convenient, right? Because all of the architects before Bramante really approached Renaissance architecture and the integration of Roman architecture from a facade sort of problem, right? So here he has this facade problem on four sides, and like his early architects, the problems occur at the corners, and we'll see those in a second. But he really comes up with this great way of understanding and mastering the height and the spanning proportions, both of not just geometry, but of the rules of Roman and Greek temple architecture, which specify very specific proportions. He resolves some of the ideas that Brunelleschi had a hard time with, like using an entablature supported by a column to allow that logic of the not only the image and the sort of visual proportion, but the structural logic of a column supporting a beam read by using these pedestals. And we saw how Brunelleschi would put the pedestal on the top between the column and the entablature, but Bramante realizes it's best to use this as a kind of cushion to do that, while also integrating the lower order of the arch between the piers, right? Because Roman architecture, as Alberti reminded us, is a pier architecture with columns applied. And we see also other iconography like Roman text and Roman writing and Latin. And also beyond, we see that in the sort of portico of the courtyard, the structure is really this kind of medieval, again, groin vault. So he integrates kind of arches behind the column, Roman semicircular arches, to Romanize that, as well as bring an entablature line here that we see integrated in the pier, right, which is right here. So he's dealing with these two scales, right? The larger scale of the building and the entablature of the building height, and the smaller scale of the arches in between. And so he's doing that weaving technique that I talked about last week that Renaissance architects use as a kind of technique to integrate these two scales at the building. Where he gets a little bit more involved, you can see it better, not in this drawing, but perhaps in this drawing here, the true structure, which is the pier, on the second floor, which is considered, remember, the second floor is always the better floor to be on, especially in the Renaissance and medieval times, because the street is dirty, it's messy, it's kind of dangerous. The second floor is the noble floor where the apartments are, where the rooms are, where you live. He integrates this kind of secondary order of this other smaller column in between the pier, and so starts to sort of develop a way to make these both Roman architecture and structure be read both logically, practically, and iconographically, right, and being correct. But he's still inventing things like here, you know, these triglyphs are really supposed to, and they actually look like pieces of wood brackets holding up the cornice of the roof. That's very correct in terms of the iconography and rules. But he's adding this double column to sort of strengthen the reading of that pier being stronger, carrying a heavy load, right? So he's very sophisticated, but like the architects before him, he hasn't quite figured out how to turn the corner. So the scroll of the Corinthian column becomes this kind of, you know, emblem of the corner embedded inside the pier. It's kind of, you know, haven't really figured out how to turn the corner. We'll see how Michelangelo does that later. They're quite interesting sort of, let's say, errors in iconography, but true kind of moments of experimentation, invention, and they're beautiful to read as we see the evolution of Renaissance architecture developing. But again, what he's doing here is, again, one of those two different elements that we saw in that early sketch of that courtyard and that domed semicircular building that was depicted in the man being skewered by a stake, the miracle of the man being skewered by a stake. We see now Bramante actually designing a courtyard, designing churches, and then eventually getting to his most important building, and probably one of the most important buildings of the Renaissance to know, the San Pietro in Montorio. This is the first St. Peter's he gets to design, a small version. So here he is, now he's designing what? A circular temple with a dome building, which looks exactly like that building we saw in the plans and sections and the painting of the first slide that I showed you. And he's the first architect in the Renaissance to actually be able to build a fully centralized circular church. So, you know, touchdown, right? Goal for the architect. But it's interesting to look at the project because today all that remains is the actual tholos and church, and it's quite sophisticated in sort of the techniques, not only in the resolution integration of the architectural and proportional systems that Renaissance architects are struggling to master and to crystallize, but also how he starts to turn the techniques that he's developed through drawing and understanding proportion and perspective and Roman elements, and inventing sort of new design techniques as well as new architectural vocabulary. First of all, the project that Bramante designed was meant to be in a circular courtyard. So it's kind of interesting that the church sits in the courtyard as opposed to being outside of the courtyard. Really interesting sort of infusion of the two. The courtyard now also becomes part of this circular universality that is the symbol of the perfection of the universe of the Renaissance that integrates religion and, in a way, humanistic and scientific thinking. The courtyard was never built, so it sits inside what's now the Spanish Academy in this kind of unfinished square courtyard. It's kind of a little bit smothered by the proportions of the courtyard. But so the courtyard was to become the frame for this, not only the frame for this object, but also integrated in the system. What's interesting here is look at the grid that's laid out in the plan. And look at also the view we have, which is the same view that we see in the section above of the person standing and looking at this, designed to be seen in perspective through the portal of the entrance. It was intentional. So Bramante is also working, again, as a perspectivalist and a sort of a theater designer, using sort of some of the skills of theater and the tools of theater to dramatize this relationship and to emphasize this relationship by being read through the eye in perspective, primarily. Mm-hmm. So we see the object through that lens of the eye. But also, he does a really interesting thing in the plan, which is to use the center point of the interior as a kind of point where the grid of the colonnade, and I'll go through this step by step, becomes a kind of lens, a kind of filter, to expand the grid, right, in a radial pattern so that the scale of the column at the base of the portico of the temple gets expanded not only in proportion, but also geometrically and perspectivally to the edge of the courtyard. Now that's pretty wild, right? He just invents this grid that brings it all together. That's very, very wild. And he also combines and expands that from looking at both the center axes, the cross axes, and using the diagonal axes in two different ways, which the Romans did all the time. And he kind of figured that out by looking at Roman monuments and created this very new system, this flexible, you know, almost like, haha, look, I figured out the rules, I'm going to play with them, right? And so here's one of Bramante's drawings. There's some differences between the drawings and the execution. But what is he doing here? So what is the building made of? Again, it's this idealized, centralized dome church plan. He adds, on top of the classical Greek and Roman pholos building, a circular temple, right? Circularly planned temple, which has a circular cella, which has a ring of columns outside of it to create a portico. But, you know, the Roman and Greek temples do not have domes on top of them. So the first invention is to actually stack the dome on top of it, which again is, the dome is a half of a sphere, right? It's a perfect circle in three dimensions, and it's a perfect geometry to symbolize this ideal of the Renaissance. And you know, we'll talk about the program in a second. It's a chapel, and I'll tell you why it's important in a second, based on this kind of circular courtyard and temple scheme. It has an underground crypt where the saint or the bones of the saint are usually buried, but St. Peter's bones are not buried there. It's a symbolic place where the sort of memory of St. Peter would be. The real St. Peter's crypt is in the other St. Peter's, we'll look at later. And again, it has this Doric peristyle, which is the most primary, the most pure of the Greek and Roman orders, but of course it's the Tuscan order because it has a base, so it's an Italianate version of that. And it also uses these kind of very good, even groupings of things based on four, like the Pantheon. Four piers, 16 columns, 8 divisions, including the corners. And it has all the great elements that we'd want to see in a Greek temple, in a Roman temple. But as we see from the sketch of the balustrade is an interesting sort of technique. It's this, why do you need a balustrade up there? Nobody's going up, nobody's actually allowed to go up there. It's a roof. But it's this visual screen that separates and in a way elevates and puts the dome in a kind of different and recessed sphere. It makes it more kind of sacred, more special, more distant. This kind of aspirational element up pointing towards the sky as opposed to the realm of the earth where one can sit, walk, and enter the chapel. So there are these kind of inventive techniques. We'll look at some more of these inventive techniques. And if you look at the next slide, we'll see some of them. So on the interior and in the plan, we'll go back to the plan. First of all, we see on the right how he's mastered this very simple way of understanding the square and the circle and using these proportions to master this visual, both mathematical and perspectival reading of the masses below and above. But he also uses it and combines it with a mastery of using architectural elements. And he borrows from Alberti in a smart way by, if we look at the plan for a second, sorry for jumping around, look at the strange shapes we see in the wall of the cella. Those shapes are made because he's, first of all, trying to accentuate the entry axis and the cross axis by making the entrances wider in the cella, not in the colonnade. The colonnade, the spacing is all even. And in the diagonal axes, which are not important, those are niches inside, he makes the opening smaller. So to sort of be able to manage this irregular or alternating spacing, we can see in this worm's eye view, he pairs columns like Alberti does, right? He makes this kind of pier, the pier, so he accentuates the corner pier and expands the center. And he creates on the inside one order, and back in the plan, we see on the outside, it's a much more regular spacing that's based on the niches that are inside the walls. And so there's this kind of weird shape. Remember that weird shape because we'll look at it when we get to St. Peter's later on. He's making this kind of plastic shaped pier, right? If we just look at the pier and isolate it, it refers to on the outside one kind of organization and spacing and on the inside another, and the resulting shape as a figure, as a material mass, it's this kind of weird element, right? So he'll pick this up later. And so there are many more inventions, but those are important ones, especially how he systematically puts these things together in a comprehensive, balanced, and sort of reasonable, if not rational, technique, method, and language, okay? So this is a sort of tour de force for architecture and for Bramante. Now, Bramante gets recognized for his great abilities, and he comes upon the greatest patron you would want to have at this time, which is probably the wealthiest person in Europe and the most powerful, the Pope. It's like having Obama as your patron, right? And the great thing about timing for both Bramante and Pope Julius II, who is his pope, he is a great patron of the arts. He also has the luxury of having this moment, this efflorescence of culture and all these amazing artists at a moment when culture is bursting, right? When it's like when in our computer age, when the computer came out and Apple came out, and wow, we could all do so much more, and our culture has transformed because of it. This is another one of those moments, and the great benefactors here are Pope Julius and the artists like Bramante and Michelangelo, who will be sort of the people to set the tone and create the new precedents for everyone to either emulate or surpass. And the importance of Pope Julius is, remember, the Pope is the head of the Catholic Church, but he's also a prince. He's the leader of the papal states, right? He's the one who controls how the papal money is used, how all the papal properties are developed, including the city of Rome, which he is partial ruler of because he is the owner and the representative of Vatican City. He's the imperator of Vatican City. In fact, remember, the popes are really, they inherit a lot of the status, traditions, and rules from the Roman Empire in a kind of unabated way, because remember Constantine, who was the Roman Emperor, who moved to Constantinople and embraced Christianity, extended the rights of leadership and rulership to the popes in Rome to take care of the city, right? Well, and that tradition continued, and therefore the popes actually inherit many of the traditions and rules, including some of the titles like Pontifex Max, which is the bridge fixer, right? The person who goes around the city and fixes bridges. And so the Pope is a person in charge in some way of urban development. So The popes before and after, but sort of at the apex of Pope Sixtus IV, and then Pope Julius, and later Pope Sixtus V, these popes, especially Julius II and Sixtus V, are very interested in turning Rome into a capital city again, the capital of Christendom and the capital city of architecture, right? That architecture becomes a kind of vehicle to express, a kind of propaganda machine, to both express the power and brilliance of both the Catholic Church and the artists that they patronize and who sort of serve and symbolize the grandeur of Rome. We don't have a great map here, but this to show you how it was, but I showed you last week that Rome had been turned into this kind of medieval pattern of very small, narrow, winding streets, and you couldn't really make use. Even today, Rome is a difficult place to find your way around without a map. But back then, it was even more difficult because you were kind of walking around like a mouse in a maze trying to find your way. And so what Pope Julius wanted to do was to sort of bring back this clarity. For instance, look at this road, which is an ancient Roman road, the Via Flaminia, which enters at the Piazza del Popolo up at the north, right? This is an old Roman road leading to the Capitoline Hill, which was the most important center and where the Roman Forum still is today and was back then. And it's the only one at the time that was this continuous, straight, logical road where you could see exactly where you were going, right? So Pope Julius II commissions Bramante and gives Bramante the kind of license, okay, you're my architect. I want you to build a grand city for me. And so even though we're looking only at a few projects by Bramante, he actually got the commission for St. Peter's, for the garden next to it, Belvedere, for the Via Giulia, which was going to be the first and is still today the first straight Roman road built in the Renaissance, cutting through this kind of maze of streets through the fabric of medieval Rome. This judicial building, which he began and was never finished, and other commissions along the way, including this road, which was only partially completed. And so this map sort of diagrams the ideal, you know, the ideal image of the organization of the new city, this new sort of grand, monumental, and again, neo-Roman, image of this monumental capital city, okay? These straight streets, these monumental buildings, which are very big, by the way. St. Peter's is huge, and so is this judicial building. It was supposed to have like 8 or 12 courts in it, courthouses stacked one on top of the other, right? So actually a great project. You should look at it if you ever have a chance. And look how big it is in reference to the Circus Maximus. It's funny how the Colosseum is not even shown here. But anyway, this is a great map to show you what the project was for Julius VI and what a great commission or set of commissions that Bramante was about to engage in. So this then begins what we call Bramante's grand manner, because he's trying to now develop a much larger scaled architecture, a large planning system using all of the different techniques of humanism and high Renaissance combination of geometry, perspective, and Roman architectural elements. And what he does is, again, synthesize this kind of system through these series of experiments and reaches this new peak of expression which other architects, including Michelangelo, will take up. And he creates, again, this we can call this organic architecture that has this kind of relationship between parts and whole, between inside and outside. It's this kind of holistic language and architectural grammar or syntax, used to resolve different problems for different kinds of buildings with different kinds of needs and challenges beyond the ones that they were invented for originally. And so he reaches this new level, and we'll look at some of these projects. And the last thing I want to mention is not only is he creating architecture, but he's creating this kind of urban design technique of creating these grand urban and public spaces. But he's also bringing, again, integrating, and we don't have time to talk about all of them, but this idea of otium. This, remember, in Roman times, the word negotium, what means to negate relaxation, and otium means relaxation, where you go into the countryside when you're not working to rejuvenate before you come back to the busyness and non-otium of the city and work. And so the Pope's palace and the Pope's villa are these places for otium reintegrated into this high level of culture. Here, I just want to remind you that there is a St. Peter's Basilica, all right? And we'll see another map later. This is what it looked like. And these are plans for what happens at the Vatican City. The first, this project by Bramante, which I'm going to go very quickly through this time. I usually take more time. And the new St. Peter's Basilica, this centralized temple, which later will be developed and completed by many architects, including Michelangelo. And we'll see a couple of the versions. of that, and we see how the palace of the Pope, which faces the public space and faces the space of the basilica, is separated and distant from what we call the country villa at the time. Even a mile distance could bring you from city to country, but even in this landscape of Vatican Hill, being away from this urban edge of the axis of the church puts you already in a kind of rural condition, so that this was close enough to the church and the palazzo, far enough away for it to be considered country because it was surrounded by farms. And so the Pope had everything at his feet within a few hundred yards, city and country. Okay, so this is you don't have to remember this for exam, and I'm going to go quickly, just so you see the example of how large the space is. It's a three-spaced, sort of privatized but public space for things like you see depicted in this image, these public festivals like the Jubilee, the 50-year Jubilee, or other celebrations, religious and otherwise, looking from the Pope's palace next to the basilica, looking beyond to the Pope's villa, beyond the edge of the courtyard. And this very interesting large-scale first-time Renaissance development has a lot of interesting inventions in it and integrates things like the colonnade and facade that form the sides to define the space. Remember the cloister of Santa Maria della Pace? That was a small experiment. This is a larger implementation of those experiments. And so we see how the facade is developed as a frame for the space. We also see how this site is developed on three different levels: a lower level near the palazzo, a middle level, which is a stepped garden. Some of these lessons come from looking at ancient Roman architecture like Praeneste, which I showed you last semester in the Roman lecture. This kind of stacked development of a landscape up to from the city up to an ancient Roman temple or an ancient Roman sacred site. And we see how basically this was designed to be seen and understood from the point of view of the Pope, from the Pope's eye in perspective. It works in one direction as a kind of scene or scenography or cinema's kind of approach. And at the other end, we see the Pope's villa with a kind of courtyard and a stairway, a ramp stairway, which we'll look at the end of this. So anyway, this is very important. Some of the interesting ways that Bramante then sort of not only sets the tone for this large-scale monumental planning, but how he begins to realize that he doesn't have to be so uptight, right? He can combine different design techniques like he did in the San Pietro in Montorio, where he used that sort of radial grid to figure out a way to integrate this different scale of architectural elements. He does a similar thing here. Look at this corner, right? Again, he's not trying to resolve how the colonnade system turns the corner. He actually is doing something more interesting. He's saying, you know, the hell with turning the corner. That's not what this project is about. Even though I have this double column pier and arch system that I borrow from Alberti and that I use to sort of create an edge and to create a rhythm and a structural reading of the space and of the facades and of the architecture, really this architecture is meant to be seen like this. So who's going to see these columns at the corner? I want the Pope to be really impressed when he's sitting at his balcony and watching this great scene, this celebration, this spectacle of event and architecture. So you really can't see at this scale what's happening at that corner. The effect is at the grander scale, right? So when he turns the corner, and you can also see here, look at how the base of the column shifts up. This column's actually shorter than the columns next to it. That's because, as you can see here, the land is sloping up to also accentuate the ground as a kind of perspectival plane to have this perspectival effect from the Pope's window and as he's walking closer. And the detail here is not the detail of the finger, it's the detail of the building, the facade, and the scene. And so all the attention should really be placed at this center where your eye ends and where what enters and goes into the building and can look back, like at Praeneste, to the scene behind. So he is on purpose, right? He's purposefully changing, playing around, breaking rules now, because the rules, you know, don't really help. They hold back the kind of overall experience. He's more interested in the overall experience and the overall space. Okay, the last piece of this is where this sequence ends. So if the sequence takes us through this portico and this kind of stage set, through the private apartments, into the entry to take us to the villa, the courtyard, and other private spaces that come later, There is also a way to move vertically and through time in this system, which is through this ramped access, which is really for the horses, for his guards, and for the Pope to be carried up through this cavalier ramp, as they call it. You see what it looks like from the outside. It's just this kind of medieval tower, but on the inside is a spiral ramp, which is a kind of three or four dimensional sort of culmination to this journey, for this perspectival journey for the Pope. And the way it's organized is quite interesting, just like in the Colosseum and other architectures that we've seen, like in Alberti's Palazzo. It's based on the Roman orders. The first two floors are Doric, the second one is Ionic, and the third one is Corinthian. And again, it only works in one direction. This logic only works as we go towards the vanishing point, vertically upward. And so this experiment is interesting. In fact, other architects take this up later, like Borromini. And so again, as all experiments, there are open ends to it. And the idea was not to complete it in the other direction, or not to worry about other aspects of it, but to simply take this Roman system and apply it to this kind of spiral vertical format. Okay, so this is another first. The last thing I'll show you about Bramante, and then we'll take a break, is the Palazzo Caprini. Here is another sort of innovative moment in Palazzo design. The last palazzo I showed you was Alberti's Palazzo Rucellai, and we saw that was a three-story building, just like the Palazzo Medici Ricciardi that I showed you in the same slide lecture last week. Here we see something different. Bramante is very interested in looking at this idea of the ground and the piano nobile, and looking at these two different orders of the rusticated system of architecture below, which has the image of the arcade, of the aqueduct, of the pier architecture that Roman architecture is made out of, without any decoration, without any Roman columns applied, and then the piano nobile, which actually is the decorated, the ornamented facade, which celebrates the Roman orders. And again, there's a lot of new sort of, a new precedent with a lot of new rules and new inventions about what palazzos could or should be made of in the future. There's another invention, and let's start from above. Above we see, again, that Bramante takes forward this idea of the double column bay, which is narrower, and it is sort of visually the structural part that has the wall with the columns applied to it. There is an entablature at the top, very simple triglyph Doric order of column and entablature. And then behind, just slightly behind that, which is the brick pier wall of the Roman architecture, we see a brick facade, which in this case is actually stucco made to look like brick. And we see these kind of pedimented tabernacle windows and openings with the balustrade like we saw at the Tempiero, right? So the piano nobile has a new architecture, very different than what we saw in Palazzo Rucellai and other architects, very elemental, very elegant, very simple, and sort of shows us all the rules in a kind of reductive way what Roman architecture is in the hands of Bramante. But below we see this kind of rusticated level without any columns, and we see also that he's playing with, one, being very accurate about what the ground floors of Roman buildings usually had in the city. They usually had storefronts. So what we see here is the depiction of which he can see in the Roman ruins in some cases, whether right at his feet inside of Rome, in the Roman Forum in some cases. I mean, it wasn't dug out like it is today, so there wasn't this big sort of living museum like we might imagine it, but there were simple fragments all over the city where one could see ancient Roman buildings and ancient Roman storefronts on the ground. And a Roman storefront usually had two stories. It had a storefront with a door and a kind of bifolded wood window, which would serve as a kind of banquette to serve the food or to serve or to show the wares. And then this kind of second story, mezzanine, where the storage was held. And there was usually a window for that space so that things could be hauled in with a rope or some, you know, you could get in and out and throw light into the upper story. So he's turning the lower level of the palazzo, the city palazzo, into a true Roman kind of urban element. And he's playing with also symmetry. Look, in general, the building is organized symmetrically. The bays above are simply repetitive, except that, you know, when we get to the end. Here the bays are repeated equally as arches, but inside of the openings we see he's doing something very strange. One, the opening is asymmetrical. So the center line sort of mirrors the banquettes of the doors on left and right. The end bays have these strange, large-scale, flat arches. What is that? Where did that come from? The Romans actually didn't really do that, right? He's inventing here. He's playing here, and I'll show you why. And he's playing a game that the mannerists will pick up later, including Raphael and other architects. where, you know, the window above seems to be framed by these very huge keystones, which seem overscaled, right? Too monumental for the size of the opening to frame this flat arch on both sides. Here, we have no arch at all, and he interrupts the what should be an extended and clear entablature, as we see from above, a clear supported entablature, and it gets broken down and somehow slightly erased behind the arch, then disappears here, and the brick seems to drop to the height of the door opening, and then the central opening becomes big again, and he alternates the clear story windows from kind of straight to circular, straight to circular, and he plays with each of these bays. So he's doing this also because he discovers this technique of construction, which is to build out of brick and rubble and to surface or face or dress the building in stucco. And the stucco is like icing on cake. It can be shaped, it can be applied at any thickness, any shape, and in a much more inexpensively and cheap way, depict masonry construction without actually having to build real arches and bricks. And this becomes a real kind of innovative moment, right? And he'll use this in St. Peter's. Okay, so let's take a little break and then come back and we'll see Michelangelo. Okay, so welcome back for the second half of our lecture on High Renaissance architecture. And we just left off with Bramante's Palazzo, which is another great image to remember, even though you won't be tested on that. Just keep it in your mind as we move towards some of these projects by Michelangelo. And first, we'll again, as we did with all these different great masters, we begin with what Michelangelo's background is. Michelangelo is first and foremost, and by his own profession and his own writing, considers himself a sculptor. No matter what he does, it comes from the point of view of his position as a sculptor, his training as a sculptor. Even so, we see Michelangelo was born, and I'm going to go remind you how old he is as we go through the lecture when he makes these great pieces of art and architecture, just to sort of maybe impress us and depress us, because he did so much while he was so young and continued to while he was so old. His first experiences, he was always a very talented young man, especially at drawing, but we see here from his first apprenticeship, and remember, architects, artists, painters, any craftsperson working with their hands had to belong to a guild, had to be trained by a master in a studio or atelier. In fact, that's kind of a model for the way we set up our studios here, right? You learn from your older professors in a studio, but in this case, you work on your own projects, right, at Pratt. At the time, you had to work as an apprentice, learning from the bottom up, as an artist, working with a great master, either helping to trace or prepare canvases or mix paint and learn the sort of fundamentals of the craft, both material, technical and visual, and representational. And then little by little, as you improved and showed your ability, you were allowed to actually complete or work on parts of the artwork. So what we see here is that Michelangelo apprentices with Domenico Ghirlandaio, who's a very well-known, very successful, primarily a painter in the Renaissance in Florence. Of course, the center of the Renaissance at the time. Very lucky to be born at the time of Lorenzo the Magnificent, who was the great banker, entrepreneur of the Medici family, and sort of, in a way, the Wizard of Oz, right? He's the kind of ruler of Florence from behind, right? He's not literally a leader, but because of his influence in business, because of his ties in business and family and across Europe, he has a lot of power and influence. And is a kind of very shrewd and clever mastermind. So anyway, he becomes a patron, and so he asks Ghirlandaio to send him his two best apprentices, and he sends to Lorenzo de' Medici, Michelangelo and Granacci, who are two another famous Renaissance painter. But this is a great painting by Ghirlandaio, very famous, where we see the sort of the birth of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and her mother, St. Anne, in this Renaissance setting with these giant Roman columns with this, what we call grotesque ornaments, and this frieze, which shows a lot of small children figure, which are, of course, a symbol for the birth of Mary below, right? This frieze that's put up there in a kind of a white plaster finish. And we see this Roman garlanded and thick entablature in this wood cabinet interior of the bedroom, right? And interestingly, of course, we see everything in perspective. The perspective point now hidden between the scenery, and this seems to be like an outdoor garden space because we see everybody walking outside the column in sort of this private interior space, not quite a bedroom, where Mary is presenting her child, or where Anne is presenting her child, Mary. And so, but it's clearly been sort of, at least by historical experts, that this might probably be the hand of Michelangelo. And it's very important, we'll see in other slides, because of this figural study, very three-dimensional, very sculptural, in a very flat, two-dimensional, not very deep piece of material and space, also drawn in perspective, okay? And we see at the time when Lorenzo, who was the patron, has this kind of academy for artists in his garden where he's collecting a lot of classical antique sculptures and artwork and brings great artists to teach, but also younger artists to be developed, to be part of his academy, his think tank, his own collection of art and artists, both ancient and new. And he brings Michelangelo in as not only as his patron, but Michelangelo gets to sit at the table with all these other great thinkers, gets to read, gets to study, gets to hear, gets to speak and debate with all these other people at the round table, both learning during the day as an artist, studying these Roman masterpieces, but also at night sort of interfacing and exchanging ideas and learning from his elders and other masters. And during the time, he does things like this, which looks very much like that frieze we just saw, this Roman battle relief. Now, of course, a relief is an interesting thing to talk about in relationship to Michelangelo. We understand Michelangelo basically as a sculptor in the round, but his early pieces are all these kind of very flat two-dimensional surfaces that he has to sculpt and create a three-dimensional depth and volumetric understanding of either bodies or bodies in architecture. And this is a great example of it. How old is he here? He's born in 1475. He's about 16 years old here, right? He's very young. He's a little bit older, and he creates his first full, in the round, marble sculpture. Now, what is the power of Michelangelo? The power of Michelangelo is his real clear understanding of the human body, both its skeletal and muscular, and skin, let's call them systems in our own language, the skin elements. And it's really interesting because here he's depicting Bacchus, who's the god, the Roman god of wine, right? The god of merriment, kind of a little bit mischievous. He's always drinking wine, so therefore he's probably always a little bit drunk. Behind him we see the satyr, which is an emblem of Pan or the faun, which is this kind of, in mythology, this kind of mischievous forest figure who's always, you know, kind of undermining or playing tricks on other gods or mortals. And we see also that this kind of full figure portrait of Bacchus is organized around this format still of contrapposto, right? That Greek format of sculpture where the body's standing on one leg and one hip is lower and the corresponding shoulder is higher and the opposite shoulder and hip are closer together. It's that contrapposto pose of the warrior holding the spear. Instead here, Bacchus is holding wine. But we also see something very different. Instead of this idealized muscular figure, we see a kind of, you know, chubby, flabby guy who's probably been drinking too much and not doing a lot of exercise. And so the way Michelangelo both depicts this kind of naturalistic proportion of the body, ideally, he also depicts the fat and the skin, as well as the kind of psychological demeanor and the kind of glazed look in the eyes and this kind of relaxed look of the mouth and the relaxed and sort of slumping hand and the slumping back of the figure. It's quite extraordinary, especially at the time, especially when you think that all these sort of material and sensorial qualities of the skin and the body and the eyes are all depicted by chiseling in stone. Michelangelo is quite amazing because most of his sculptures, in fact all of his sculptures, are chiseled from one piece of stone marble block, usually white Carrara marble, right? And so again, there is a limit in the size of the block within which he can actually create all of this kind of rich range of expression, material, and anatomical precision, but also evocative expression of both, not just the physical qualities, but the actual mental and emotional state through this kind of figural sculpture. It's quite a tour de force, right? Okay, kind of moving back and forth. Another important sculpture, which we all know, by now, I'm sure, without even having to go to art or architecture school, is the Pietà, right? Which is the scene of Mary, the mother of Christ, the Son of God, after his crucifixion, being taken down from the cross as a dead 30 or 32-year-old figure. And, of course, what she's, it's really pathos, right? Pietà's pathos, sadness, right? She's expressing the sadness of her lost dead son, who is not only the dead son of not only her own dead son, but the Son of God, the Son of all Christians, for whom Christ sacrificed himself on the cross to save and all of the souls in purgatory, cleansing them of original sin, allowing them to go to heaven, right? Okay, so that's the story and the narrative, but the sort of real sort of masterpiece here can be explained in a few descriptions. I just first point to, again, remember, the limits that Michelangelo either accepts or challenges himself with. Here's another early bas-relief when he's around 16 years old of Mary and Jesus, right, the mother and child. It's interesting here, though, like in the previous bas-relief, in the previous bas-relief, we see that this is a kind of Roman classical version of men at war. Back then, Greeks and Romans either were fully naked or partially naked when they fought, and we see these kind of muscular bodies. Here, we see that even though this is supposed to depict Mary and child, the child's back, Christ's back is to us, Mary's in profile. So the limits of the bas-relief don't stop him from being able to three-dimensionally develop more of what he's interested in, this kind of sculptural, figural, three-dimensional development of bodies in space. And the space not only is in depth and perspective, it's also beyond, and even where your eye level is, and where these figures are beyond the stair, that are overlapped partially by the last stair. He's got a real mastery of trying and this kind of striving to go beyond the two dimensions, striving to go beyond the limits of the material and the limits of the space is always in Michelangelo. Here, it's even further developed in the sort of, how do you describe sadness, the pathos, the pain of loss, right? It's described mostly and solved mostly in these two sort of simultaneous ways. First of all, if we look at the face of Mary, she really looks like she did when she was the virgin mother. The story goes that Mary was a virgin and that she was made pregnant by divine right by God, not by physical intercourse. And so she was this lovely child who sort of innocently became pregnant and had this son. And at the time of the death of her son, Michelangelo depicts her as a young woman, not as an old lady in her, you know, not a middle-aged or older woman who would have had a 30-year-old son. And so it's kind of very symbolic and very expressive, not very, in a way, you know, surreal in a way, although it's not meant to be surreal. It sort of describes her purity. It describes who she is and who she was, the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God. And she's also small. She's a small woman who possibly, even at 16, couldn't possibly hold a dead body in her hands, a dead adult male's body in her hands very easily. So Michelangelo solves that visual conundrum by creating this huge pyramidal composition where the clothing, the cloth, around her legs especially, become more monumental, become bigger than her. Her head is small, her body is a bit more inflated by her clothing and her drapery. And then her legs and the drapery become this visual base for, and this expressive base, because even her clothing and the wrinkles on the cloth, which again come from a kind of understanding of Greek sculpture, right? Especially female Greek sculptures, where the robe somehow and its kind of style and its expression depict qualities of the individual. Here, this kind of wrinkling depicts one, you know, the kind of support that she has to have, supporting her dead son, but also expresses the sadness and the expression through the kind of folding and wrinkling as if it's kind of, you know, itself in tension. Like Mary is internally, even though her face seems very solemn and graceful inside, her emotions are expressed on the sort of folds of the fabric and on this kind of weight that this sculpture is supporting, as well as looking at, you know, look at that fold of the skin and look at the veins, the real sort of extremely almost, you know, photographic representation and reproduction of the human body and all the stresses and strains and also the sort of fatigue as well as relief in the face of the dead face of Christ, as well as the hollow eyes of the dead body, right? It's extremely, extremely realistic and naturalistic, and there's nothing like it before or for some time after the sculpture. And again, Michelangelo is a very young man here. He's about 25 years old when he does this masterpiece. Okay. Another important thing to know is that because Michelangelo considers himself a sculptor, we have few elements, but we have a lot of evidence of his ability as a painter. Remember, at the same time that Leonardo da Vinci depicts the Mona Lisa, again, this is not how the Mona Lisa looked. It was probably colored like this at the time of its painting, its completion. And then because Leonardo da Vinci was both an artist and a scientist, he always experimented with different techniques of painting to get the qualities he wanted, many times not caring about what would happen after the experiment. And so over time, both the effects of light and the effects of just chemical reaction between the kind of materials he used, this painting has become this kind of dark image that we know. But at one time it had the same kind of bright, exuberant color and qualities that we see. However, we also see kind of the technique and, you know, Michelangelo knowing about how landscape is depicted in the scene. Although that's not the central subject of the scene, we can see that the same techniques of the Renaissance are being used both in the earlier generation of masters and artists and the newer generation. I show this to you because it's an interesting segue also to the Sistine Chapel. This is called the Holy Family Doni Tondo. Doni is the person, the cardinal who actually is the patron for the painting. The tondo just means that it's a round painting, a painting in the round. Obviously, there's a strong humanistic reason and religious reason why this is a circular frame, because the circle, of course, is the ideal geometry in the Renaissance, and Michelangelo is putting it to full use. But it also describes the kind of unity of the Holy Family, Mary, Jesus, and Saint Joseph. And we see that Michelangelo is also using the sort of gesture and the position of the figures in typical Michelangelo style. Who really feels comfortable sitting like that? I certainly wouldn't feel comfortable with my leg, but it's a kind of expression of the roles and the sort of position of each of these elements. Mary is actually the center of it all, right? She's in the middle. She is also the figure that bridges heaven and earth. In fact, in most religious art, where Mary is depicted, she becomes the kind of, as we saw in the paintings I showed you last week by Giotto and Cimabue, she is the go-between for Christ, right, on earth. She is that sort of mother figure, the female figure, who softens the tragic story of Christ for believers and is also the mother between God, the Father, and herself. Saint Joseph is hidden behind and also becomes the kind of symbol, in a way, of the heavenly God. And so, you know, the way this building, the way this is organized and the compositional elements are really sophisticated. The circle is important. The circle here that unifies through the arms of Mary, the arms of Jesus, and the head of Mary at the center is another kind of smaller circle inside the larger circle placed at the upper half of the canvas. And look at how Mary's head is below the horizon. She is on earth while Christ is, you know, is being lifted by her and Joseph heavenly towards the heavens. Okay, so they are the main scene, but look at how almost half the painting is this kind of sculptural obsession that Michelangelo has with depicting the body in its most sort of expressive volumetric and sort of dramatic positions. Okay, and also look at how the fabric and the colors accentuate the sculpture, the light, the three-dimensionality. The conceit here is also, who are these people in the background? They're just more sculptural figures. Michelangelo can't help himself. He's showing these classical figures like he did in that battle scene. He's showing the human nude. He's showing how there is this relationship between religious and pagan culture of ancient Rome in the background. And all of these somehow are trying to be integrated into this one scene in the circle. He even designs this beautiful gold gilt frame with Christ's head and portrait and the four apostles who write the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and of course decorated with this ancient Roman floral garlanding, right? So it's a full interdisciplinary piece for Michelangelo. So just so you see what he does as a painter in one very unique painterly commission. Okay, so this is the one everybody knows, probably the most famous sculpture on the planet, maybe the most famous artist in the world. Debatable, but you know, certainly people make that claim. The Statue of David is another one of these pieces that Michelangelo embraces as a challenge. There's this piece of block of stone that's laid outside the church of Santa Maria, forgetting names now. Anyway, near the Duomo, there's this block of stone that's dedicated to a commemorative statue of the statue of David, which is supposed to be a symbol of the Republic of Florence. And many artists are approached, there's competitions. Finally, that's another great story that will take a beautiful, would be like a half an hour to tell the story completely and well. But in any case, Michelangelo is chosen, including by some recommendation by Donatello. And here he is. He takes this very restricted vertical block of stone, and within this narrow shaft, he has to depict the story of David who slays Goliath. Right? We've seen that story and that figure depicted by Donatello maybe 40 or 80 years earlier. So the dates, I think it's 80 years earlier. And we see David, this kind of supposedly 16-year-old, looks much, perhaps the face looks a little older, certainly the musculature is very mature for a 16-year-old boy who uses a sling to slay this very large and imposing warrior on the who he slays by using a sling, which he uses as a shepherd to kill wolves who are after his sheep, and he's so proficient at it that he kills the most famous warrior of the enemies of the Israelites. And so here we see David depicted, but he's not doing anything. He's standing there, and this is very important in terms of one, that is, of course, using this sort of contrapposto pose and this idealized and naturalistic but idealized human male figure, right, fully in the nude, so we can see the beauty of the human figure. It is strangely proportioned on purpose, like the head is very big, the hands are very big, the legs seem skinny and probably too short, because this is meant to be seen not the way this photograph is taken, but from below, from far away, where the sculpture's higher up. So Michelangelo is actually making adjustments for the perspectival, for shortening, so that the head doesn't look too big or too small from far away when it's in the proper position. So when it's photographed this way, it shows also Michelangelo's skill at understanding perspective and proportion relative to the body and foreshortening. And it's actually not necessarily meant to be seen from the back. The back is less fully developed. And in typical classical style, there's this stump of tree, which usually ends up being a literal physical support for this piece of stone sculpture, which could crack otherwise if it wasn't buttressed there at the leg, a little bit of architecture engineering there. And what's also interesting is how the sling is hidden on his back and the stone is sort of concealed in his right hand. But what's also important is that it's not only this great physical depiction and this real kind of rebirth of this classical format, but it's actually something that Michelangelo and the artists of the time are trying to do, is go beyond the grandeur and magnificence of the achievements of these classical sculptors. And it's different in that the face is not just this idealized face, it's actually the face of somebody in a moment of deep thought. Look at the furrowing of the eyebrows, look at the sort of laser-like focus at the target that he's thinking about, and it's this moment before the action where the thinking, right, the thinking Renaissance mind is preparing for a very determined kind of action. And it's also interesting how the hair, like in the drapery on the bodies, becomes again not just an expression of his youth and his kind of richness, but it's almost like, you know, his brains are his hair. They're kind of like he's thinking really hard. The hair is doing a lot of work, right? And since I don't have any, it makes it even more impressive. But anyway, so there's this kind of tension, right, in the moment, which also expresses the tension that's in this time of the development in the Renaissance, where artists and scholars and scientists and intellectuals are realizing that, you know, they have a lot to offer. The human being, the individual, is full of talent, full of power, and somehow it's just starting to be released, and the sort of sense of individuality and the power of individuality is becoming a kind of cultural awareness. And so this kind of tugging between humanism and the beliefs of Christianity begins to sort of create a tension in both individuals and in the institutions that sort of foster both independent secular human activity and religious sort of modesty and subjugation to the church and the ideals of religion. And it's an interesting time, right? Science and religion begin to pull away from each other. And so this is just a reminder that when you go to Florence, this is actually a copy of that sculpture I showed you, which was placed in the late 1800s in the Accademia, which is the Academy of Art and small museum there. So this is the copy, this is the original. And this sculpture is placed here, but it was actually meant to be placed higher up on a pedestal on the facade. And so that explains why the perspective and the foreshortening of the sculpture works the way it does. And we can see, again, the difference between Greek ideal and Roman copies of Greek ideal sculptures. There is a subtle difference in terms of what is being described in the story and how the individual describes that story versus a kind of idealized picture of either a warrior or a mythological figure. And remember, only this date is wrong here. This should be 1500. You can see that 80 years earlier, Donatello's attempt, which was, again, very naturalistic, maybe even more realistic, because he's showing a 16-year-old boy and what most 16-year-old boys look like, not so fully developed as a kind of mature physical body. But we see the real kind of transformation over 80 years and how Michelangelo pushes forth sculpture. Now, well, transitioning into architecture, of course, it happens at this very important commission, which we're looking at the Sistine Chapel ceiling, which is, of course, by Michelangelo, and in Beyond the Sistine Chapel, Last Judgment, we'll look at both of those two paintings briefly. But I want to look at this from this point of view first, because regardless of what the content is, look at how Michelangelo begins to deal with what he's given, the limits, the context, right? And this is a great lesson for architects, right? We all love to make cool-shaped buildings, but really getting inspiration and integrating the sort of limits of what's given to you is part of what architecture's challenge is, right? And Michelangelo, without knowing it, is rising to that challenge. And we see how this church, or this small chapel, which is based on, I told you earlier in another lecture, Sistine Chapel is based on the Temple of Solomon and writings in the Bible. And so this little chapel, which is the Pope's private chapel for he and the cardinals, is a kind of medieval structure, which he paints over. There's these earlier paintings by artists, and there's earlier paintings by medieval artists that are then painted over by Michelangelo. So we've lost a lot of great art to this endeavor, but we've gained so much more. We see this attention to a knowledge of architecture by Michelangelo actually working with the format of the pier and the window that happen at the wall below, and how he begins to extend a visual logic of structure, right? These are kind of extending the logic of the columns to the ribs of the painted ceiling, and then this idea of an entablature, right, which begins to set up a framework for him to paint his figural story of the stories of the Bible on the ceiling, which is his commission given to him by Pope Sixtus, by Pope Julius II, again, this great patron. But that comes after this earlier commission that Michelangelo was very excited to have, the tomb that Julius had commissioned Michelangelo for his own burial, for the Pope's burial. So Michelangelo begins, and we see some sketches of pieces, some conjecture drawings, and some historical reconstructions of what the design of that tomb was to look like. Clearly, it has some relationship to what we see in that later Sistine Chapel ceiling. Michelangelo understands architecture, understands that columns and that entablatures are part of the world of classical architecture, but for him, they become a framework and a background for him to create, and also, in a way, they are also sculpture, which are counterpointed to the figural sculptures that he's going to make of human figures, right? And so he's going to make this great sarcophagus base and this frame behind with the sarcophagus of where the Pope's body will be laid to rest eventually, here at center, with depicting great church prophets like Moses. And in fact, the Moses statue is the only piece that ever actually gets finished for this commission. And this sits today in this kind of unfinished, very flat, two-dimensional frame. There's the Moses in the St. Peter in Chains, which was Pope Julius's family's church. And that's all that exists and remains of this commission. But Michelangelo, for many years, look at that, from 1505 to 1520, for 15 years, attempts to go back to this commission and finish it for the Pope. But the Pope keeps him busy with other things, and politics move him around. But we see the sort of beginning of Michelangelo being interested in how to understand the relationship of these figural sculptures and architecture as a kind of sculptural project. And so we first see him dealing with that in the Sistine Chapel ceiling, where he actually does interesting things in both the sculpture. These sculptures are unfinished sculptures of the slaves, which were supposed to be the kind of caryatids at the base of the sarcophagus support, and they actually sit in the same museum where the original David is. As you walk in, they're on the left, or they're on the right. There are four of them in different stages of non-completion. But it's also interesting to see how the body acts as a kind of column. The caryatid, which is an old Greek technique that we can see at the Erechtheion and other buildings that you've seen in lectures by Donald and others, that the body becomes sort of integrated in this story of architecture and support. We can actually see that integrated at the base of the entablatures, or what are meant to be entablatures, at the edges of the ceiling. And so that's really important to remember as we see how that becomes part of Michelangelo's consciousness, and how the column actually becomes more expressive of the body than the bodies do sometimes in these paintings. And we see what's really more important is how in the center panels at the top of the vault, took Michelangelo 4 years to complete this commission, 2 years on one end and 2 years at the other. A kind of interesting little side note is that the scaffolding that Michelangelo used to be able to be at the ceiling and paint with himself and his support staff was actually designed and executed by Bramante. Now, Michelangelo, I didn't explain, and Bramante and Raphael were kind of two polar kind of ends of types of practice or types of approaches or personality types. Michelangelo was a loner. He was the true symbol of the kind of individual artist, and he stood for his whole life that sort of identity, that he was a singular artist doing his own work. His staff, really his supporters, they mixed paint, they built ladders, they helped him, but it was really all his work, right? He never had an assistant who finished his projects. He had people who prepared his work so he could do it himself, which is most of the time the difference between that kind of practice by the individual in the Renaissance and the kind of atelier that he came from, like Ghirlandaio's atelier, where the pupils would do a lot of the work and the master either put finishing touches or was in charge of the design, kind of the way an architecture office today is run. While Bramante and Raphael were very used to working in teams, to working in collaboration, to working with lots of artists and being able to, you know, also handle different kinds of people and have good relationships, good working relationships, including lifelong relationships with popes. Imagine that. Could think about your clients in the future. And if you'll be able to find clients who hang out with you like your buddy, or are actually, you know, more somebody who's your taskmaster, I'm sure a pope who's in charge of very many issues, people, and complexities is not an easy person to get along with. But people like Bramante and Raphael actually became the pope's personal friends. So these are two completely different models that are set simultaneously, and there are ranges of those models in between in the Renaissance of the ways personality types and people practiced both as architects and artists. So Michelangelo was the individual guy, and he hated Bramante and Raphael. He hated them. They respected him until they met him, and he basically cursed them out. So that's a kind of, you know, 20th century, very short version of the story. But it's interesting that they also were commissioned to design, Bramante and then his assistant Raphael later, were commissioned to sort of design and execute the scaffolding for executing this painting. Okay, so here we see Michelangelo, and it's always interesting to look at the end of the first series and the beginning of the second series of this two-year commission. And in the beginning, Michelangelo, you know, kind of struggles with this. He says, I'm not a painter. I've done frescoes, but I'm not a painter. I'm a sculptor. He argues with the Pope. Why do you want me to do this? He really has no choice. He has to do this commission. Who could refuse the Pope? At the same time, it's a challenge. And we can see in the earlier compositions, there's kind of a stiffer, more kind of like rigid body composition, and also the way the story is told is a little bit more kind of like a cartoon. But when we get to the last scenes where Adam is being created by God, we see Michelangelo, one, changing his style. One, because during that time, the Farnese family and other rich families are digging up Rome, right? Like there's all this great stuff underground that's been buried for centuries, buildings, sculptures, and this sculpture, one of many, gets unearthed, right? Now, I have to also remind you, up till this time, a lot of people are taking sculptures and buildings and breaking them down, using the columns to build other buildings and churches because Rome is poor. They're taking very beautiful pieces of sculpture, melting them down to make lime to build buildings. So a lot of great sculptures lost. Now the culture changes. There is this value in antiquity and in ancient Rome as a kind of treasury underground of secret beautiful things that nobody knows about, and the wealthy families are doing all they can to dig up and find these things. And the Farnese family find this famous Roman sculpture, a copy of a famous Greek sculpture called the Lacoan, and the story is about this Trojan priest who tells the Trojans, don't trust the Greeks, they're going to give you this very important gift of a horse, but don't trust them, it's a trick. And so the Greeks send their priests and their mythological gods to kill this priest and his sons, right? So this is the scene of when the Greeks send this mythological serpent to kill and strangle both that priest and his sons. And for the Romans and for Michelangelo and the Farnese, wow, what is this wild sculpture? Look at this thing. It doesn't look anything like we have around us. It's extremely expressive. Yes, there is this similarity to the way that Renaissance artists depict the body. They understand anatomy, they understand, but look at the extremely emotional, dramatic, theatrical way that this story is being told in these three figures and the snake. And the snake actually doesn't look like he's actually doing anything bad. It looks like he's tickling them, really, in my opinion. But he actually is strangling them, right? But the way that it's done so gracefully and so dramatically impresses Michelangelo. And this and another sculpture, Hercules, really impress him and changes even his style. And so we see both his experience at learning how to do fresco successfully, teaching himself as he goes along, and this new kind of discovery changed the way he begins to depict not only painting, and in this fabulous series of panels, including this is probably the best one in many art scholars' opinions, as well as in the depiction of the many prophets and sibyls at the bases of these different frames, which depict all of the scenes from the Old Testament and the New Testament, from the Old Testament only. We see this difference in the way Michelangelo begins to use the body itself as a kind of expressive element, tool, or ornament. Okay, so you should study the Sistine Chapel. That's worth a course in itself. I'm sorry I can't spend more time on it because it's a magnificent piece of art. And I just call to mind this other important painting that he does in the same space, which is The Last Judgment, which he's asked to do many, many years later, when he's much late, older, in the 1530s and 40s. And again, just a little bit of art history, because I think you all should, you know, begin to see where all these things build up on each other. This is also very much inspired by something that many artists, including Leonardo da Vinci and other artists, went to see at Orvieto, this other depiction of the Last Judgment by Luca Signorelli. But before Michelangelo's Last Judgment, this was kind of the Last Judgment depiction par excellence, at least in Europe. Hieronymus Bosch had done some earlier in Northern Europe, but a very, very different style and era, which also depicts the kind of, here you don't see, you know, you don't see the guys that are going to hell, really, they're not really as sad as the people going to hell in this painting, right? They're really being tortured here. So there's this kind of introduction after Michelangelo, one, sees this sculpture, and two, after decades of listening to this person here, Savonarola, who was the head of the Church of San, my brain's not working, the Medici Church on the outskirts of town. I'll remember the name of the church where the Frangelico paintings are. And he's basically telling all of the people who are in power, who are interested in the material world and material wealth, you guys are really violating the basic tenets of what God is teaching, of the Bible, and he orders all those who believe in God to burn all of their riches. It was the famous bonfire of the vanities, to renounce the earthly wealth, to renounce these terrible values and get back to the tenets of the Bible. Or else, when you die, you will have skewered with pitchforks and barbecued by the devil, right? Basically, damning and condemning, suffering for eternity if one does not practice religious in a kind of more pure and stoic way than these Renaissance merchants who were living with great wealth and with great power and sort of denying their kind of spiritual their spiritual promise to God, right? So we see here, even in that story, this kind of tension. But Michelangelo was a very religious person, and he kind of believed what Savonarola was saying. So his depiction of this scene lends a little bit to this kind of imagination that came from these stories told at the pulpit, as well as of this discovery of this kind of later Hellenistic sculpture, which you've seen last semester, and you know what Hellenistic sculpture is. It's very evocative, very dramatic, very melodramatic. And so Michelangelo adopts this in his sculpture. Now we shift more fully to architecture. And I'll get it done. What time is it? Yeah, we should be able to get it done by 11. So here is Michelangelo's first architectural proposal and commission. There's a competition for completing the facade of San Lorenzo. Remember San Lorenzo I showed you last week by Brunelleschi. In that church has, you know, numerous masterpieces in it, at least three magnificent ones, two, the main church and the old chapel by Brunelleschi and the new chapel by Michelangelo, which we'll see shortly, as well as the facade design by Michelangelo, which was the winning competition entry. It was never built, but we'll see how it was designed, and basically comes off of the sketch. And you also should know that part of architectural practice in the Renaissance was to, you do a sketch like this. Drawings were not, there were no renderings, right? Almost no renderings. First of all, paper was expensive, so artists tended to use the same piece of paper and draw over and over on it because it was more expensive than sheepskin. And so we don't see many drawings, and when we have a rare drawing like Michelangelo's sketches, you know, it's rare to us, but it was not that important to them back then. It was just a way of thinking, like having your own sketchbook. But what they would do is present a fully developed scaled model, usually big models, like, you know, this big, right? Or bigger. Or models you could actually stick your head in and get a sense of how the space would be, especially if it was a very prominent client like a pope. So anyway, we see this beautiful wood model, which shows us a very different kind of proposition of architecture, again, based on this idea that Michelangelo sees himself as a sculptor. For him, architecture is just another version of sculpture that he can mold to his own benefit. And we see that instead of expressing what we've seen in previous church facades, like Alberti, we don't see, like in Alberti's earlier facades, where we see this kind of description of the profile of the typical basilican section, which is a nave with a very high double-story facade and side aisles with lower and smaller side wings, right? Remember how the basilican section works? Here we see the expression of that somehow, because we see this sort of Michelangelo's version of a Greek temple front, but maybe with a kind of Bramante-esque or Albertian-esque paired column pier. So we understand that that's kind of the nave. And then the side aisles, which are, you know, flanking and mirrored, right, and not necessarily separate elements, but fragments, right, end fragments, bookends to the building, creating this kind of squarish or rectangular facade surface, hiding the kind of void above the clerestory. But what he's interested in here is not so much to create a facade, but to create a framework like the tomb of St. Julius that would have numerous figural sculptures in it. So what's missing here are the sculptures. What is he looking for? Another opportunity to get more sculptures into his work of art, more importantly, to get more commissions, right? To be able to do like 16 or 20 more sculptures. You can see from the sketch some idea of where on the top of the facade there would be some other sculptures, right? But imagine this very much like Pope Julius's tomb full of sculpture. That was Michelangelo's intention. Facade was never built. As you can see from an aerial photograph, clearly from at least last century, if not this one, you see the facade still the way I showed it to you last week, unfinished till today. And we see the outside addition of the new chapel, which is here, which flanks the old chapel by Brunelleschi, and completing this kind of cross axis, and this is a later piece added later in the 1600s, between the 16 and 79s, we see Michelangelo's new sacristy. Okay, last week I didn't talk much about the old sacristy by Brunelleschi. I'll only talk about it here in comparison because Michelangelo, again, accepts these formats. He's not doing it with his hands tied behind his back. Somebody says, listen, you better do this the way I tell you or we're going to chop your hands off. He's actually embracing these formats because he sees it as a challenge. He respects these formats like he respects the contrapposto pose of the ancient Greeks. So there's this kind of respect and challenge to sort of take something that exists, do it better than anybody else, but then also add to it. So he wants to better Brunelleschi in some way. And what he does is changes very little, but what he does change is very significant. On the surface of the kind of volumetric organization, the only thing he changes is that he adds this kind of attic story to this kind of square base that Brunelleschi creates to support the dome for the sacristy. Michelangelo adds this kind of attic story between the spherical pendentive and dome region of the sacristy, and in effect creating a much taller tower-like space, and also in effect changing the way light comes in, which makes it slightly different in experience, but extremely similar, if not the same, in terms of a material program and agenda. As you can see from here, he uses the same materials, same kind of elements. He has the spherical pendentive and dome to support on this kind of squarish base, He also uses the Pietra Serena, which is this gray stone from Tuscany, very strong and very clear in color. And then he plasters the walls in white to create this kind of distinction between the sculptural elements, the architectural elements, which are sculptural elements, and the sort of wall itself. A little bit different than Brunelleschi, but Brunelleschi also had to compromise a little bit because he was working with other artists who were decorating some of these kind of rondelles, but we see a very similar architecture. What we'll also see in Michelangelo, however, is this kind of dialogue or balance between different kinds of elements. I'm going to go back to the sculpture in a second, stick with the architecture. So we see in any one of these bays of frames, right? Maybe we should start with the, we can start by looking at here. You see how the end bays of the space are actually pushed or narrower than the central bay that supports the arch that is on top of the entablature that goes all the way around and unifies the lower level, supported both in the corners and at the interval between the side and the center panel are these very strong sculptural and pretty faithful Roman pilasters, right? But in between those gray, you know, very sort of classical and rule-following elements, except at the corner, we still see Michelangelo hasn't figured out how to turn the corner either in this commission. We see this other architecture in white, this other architectural elements that are complete inventions by Michelangelo that seem to either be squeezed by the gray architecture or being are pushing against, vertically and horizontally, against the constraining gray of the traditional orders, right? So that's interesting. And also when you look at, I don't know which photograph is better, probably this one. When we look at this in elevation, we see that the sequence of the elements between the framing architecture, we find that he has these kind of tabernacle windows, again, where he's inventing columns, details that are not purely Roman. He's, as a sculptor now, saying, hey, listen, I can invent my own sculpture as a counterpoint to these architectures. We see these windows are not touching the architecture. In fact, they seem like they're floating away. You know, they're separate, they're isolated. They seem like they're floating. They're not supported by anything on the wall, as opposed to these arched pediments that are broken now, right? A broken pediment. Uh-oh, something's going on here. Michelangelo's really starting to question, literally challenge and break the rules of classical architecture, including its structural reading. What are these floating elements? Well, they're like paintings, they're like sculptures attached to the wall. And we see in the arched area of the upper base that is framed by the spherical pendentives, we see again this arched tabernacle window with this tapered frame that's smaller at the top and narrow at the top and wider at the bottom, with this kind of dangling draping column, almost as if it's like a, you know, inflated with helium, pushing and touching the top of the arch, or it's tacked there like a tack, right? Like it's hanging like a drape. So there's this very interesting sense of structure, support, and the opposite, right? This kind of question of the weight and the sort of gravity and material properties of the architecture, the materials. Remember when he was doing the sculptures of La Pietà, where he had to make a 16-year-old girl support a, you know, 32-year-old dead body? This question of the weight of the body, the weight of material, and its iconographic and symbolic quality, right? Of course, this is a sky aspirant space. He makes it into a tower, and these architectural elements, as they go higher, they become lighter, they become more liberating, they become free, like the soul, right? Climbing to heaven, okay? So I think that's probably the more important lesson for you as architects, and since I'm not a great art historian, I won't spend too much time talking about the sculptures like I usually do. However, we can see here in this sacristy, which has three functions like the other sacristy. It's both a burial chamber for the two dead sons or nephews of Lorenzo de' Medici. It is also a sacristy where the priest gets ready for mass, and it's also a chapel, right? The small family masses are held here. But we can see in the two tombs something also interesting, just in passing, the personality of the two sons, one who is much more contemplative and brooding, we can see from his own portrait figure, and one who's much more, because he's not wearing a helmet and he's looking out, one who's much more sort of gregarious and personable, are symbolized by two sculptures over their sarcophagi. One which is much more clear, like the idea, the difference between night and day, one which was much more vague, which is described by that transitional time between dawn and dusk, right? A little more vague, a little bit more discreet, a little less polar than those kind of experiences and clear sort of experiences of night and day. And we see the sculptures, the male and female sculptures here. They're looking out at us as opposed to here. They're turning their backs because it's either waking or sleeping, right? So there is an expression, although we have much less sculpture. Michelangelo wanted to fill this with even more sculpture. Commission was never finished. We see how the architecture also somehow describes the kind of space within which the sculptures are, also describes the kind of dignity and quality, even the there's slight differences in some of the details, and that relates to this kind of way that Michelangelo wants to express the qualities of the individual through the architectural and sculptural components. Clearly, you know, this is there's always this idea about gravity, how these pieces of sculpture seem to be sliding off of this scroll-like top of the sarcophagus. It's all part of Michelangelo's way of dealing with those qualities of weight and gravity and the expression of this kind of tension between these two kinds of conditions of stability and tension, right? So we get to see, and I'm not going to talk about, sorry about that noise, I'm not going to talk about the, at all about Laurentian Library, because Ed does such a great job of it, and since it is really on the Mannerist lecture, I'm just showing it because this is happening next, and the only thing I want to say about this is that Michelangelo finally does figure out how to turn the corner with classical architecture, which is simply by making the pilaster and the column fully three-dimensional columns and occupying the space of the corner on an inside corner by seeing two sides of the faces of these embedded architectural elements. And I have to say, again, because Michelangelo was a sculptor, it kind of allowed him to think about the problem in a different way than an architect would, who would probably most likely be dealing with it as a kind of two-dimensional measured mathematical problem as opposed to a three-dimensional sculptural problem. So I point to that just as a kind of end to the essay of how do you turn the corner with classical architecture, and move to some of his the two final projects, which are Michelangelo's very important contributions to Rome and contributions to architectural history. One is the Campidoglio, which is the piazza which is in front of the Senate building, the old Senate building of Rome, and the mayor's office today in Rome, and how he solves this problem of taking this medieval murky mess, which used to be the most important hill in the Roman Empire, facing the most important space behind that building, in the building which is called the Tabularium, facing the Roman Forum. And Michelangelo's solution is clarity, right? One is that symmetry becomes the solution, although the way he deals with the symmetry here, and reinventing the facade so that they are symmetrical. He builds a new building, he puts a new facade in an old building, and he renovates the back of the Senate building, making it the front to the piazza, which is really the back entrance to the Campidoglio, if you think about it. But it really is the front entrance to two important things, a very important Roman church, and of course the center of the government of the city, and the sort of administrative offices of the time. And we see in plan, what he does is that the building that he inherits is at an angle. So very intelligently, all he does is take the central axis and mirrors the new building, which is actually called the new building, which didn't have a function at the time, which masks this Christian, early Christian building and very ancient Roman building, and then drapes these two different facade systems, which are very important, and we see it and we know it today, and also how the paving system works, which also frames and anchors the very famous statue of Marcus Aurelius, a great Roman emperor, this kind of equestrian statue, which again today stands a copy, and the original stands in the museum to the right. And what does Michelangelo do? I think I'm just going to, just for purposes of brevity, this is his solution. He figures out the system of the facade, which deals with the building scale of the colossal scale of the entablature, the entablature, the pilaster, and the pedestal, and the smaller scale of the two stories of the building with the smaller scale column and entablature that gets interrupted by the vertical colossal scale. And then, in a way, he's also a little bit on the second story, borrowing a bit from Bramante, although it's not quite Bramante-esque because there are no double columns. He's using the colossal column as the divider of the bays that separate it into the structural bays of the building. But we see that second smaller scale of the entablature of the smaller scale of the column order below sort of running behind or next to or interrupted by the verticals. And I'm looking at this, and we'll look at this because it very much influences the St. Peter's solution. Okay, so we'll get to St. Peter's now. So as we saw before, and I love this map, so does Donald, this map is the Lanciani map, which shows in red, let's say, the contemporary architecture, in gray, very early architecture, Roman architecture. What we see here very, very lightly is the stadium of Nero. So this hill, before it became a religious site, was an ancient Roman playground. It was where a stadium, it was like going, you know, football stadium, right? And that football stadium is where St. Peter was actually sacrificed. And where St. Peter was sacrificed was inside the stadium, and he asked to be crucified upside down because he didn't think himself worthy of being crucified the same way as Christ. And St. Peter was the apostle upon which Christ wanted to build his church from, and so therefore that's why St. Peter is so important in the iconography of Christianity. He's the first pope, actually. He's buried here, outside the wall of the stadium where he was sacrificed. Why would that be? Okay, so this, at one time, was on the outskirts of Rome, outside the so-called walls, although there really weren't any walls at that time. Walls came later. And because, as you remember from maybe the Etruscan lecture I gave, that there was the city of the living, and you never buried anybody in the city of the living. The city of the dead was outside the city. So this was a place where when people were killed, they would just be buried alongside the stadium. So there are actually many crypts here of people who were martyrs or people who died. And, you know, loved ones or people who followed them would create a little sign, a little rock, maybe a little tabernacle or a place to put a candle or put an offering. And St. Peter's bones were there. And the church, actually, the early Christian church, was founded and built around that as a kind of marker, right? In fact, all of the buildings here are sprung from that seed of St. Peter's tomb, including the new basilica, which we'll be seeing, which is what you see in red, the basilica and the colonnade, which you'll see, I think, next week in John's lecture. And so it's interesting for us as architects to see a document like this, and for all of you in first year learning about what drawings do. This is a fantastic drawing. It's a historical layer drawing. You can see the early St. Peter's, the early structure that explains not only the Roman foundations, but also the story of, you know, where we find St. Peter's bones and how architecture actually sprouts, like, you know, like agriculture, from this kind of, these set of events, okay? So the new St. Peter's, which we see in red, that plan is actually, the parts you see are Michelangelo's plan, okay? All right, but this is the original early plan of Bramante, and I didn't talk about it in Bramante's lecture, just not to ruin, and I think Ed will talk about this a little bit also. I'm only going to touch on how Bramante planned, and remember I showed you the original small St. Peter's, the San Pietro Montorio. That was a kind of a, that was a little bit of a trick by the church, because there was this story about where St. Peter was buried that was, I cannot, you know, they weren't sure if St. Peter actually was killed in the stadium or killed and buried somewhere near a pyramid, right? And there's a pyramid tomb outside of Rome, and so to sort of place their bets in both places as an homage to the stories of the death of St. Peter, the San Pietro Montorio lies directly between the two pyramids that were described in the story where he was buried, just to make sure they didn't make a mistake. But the actual burial was the one on the Vatican Hill. And so when Bramante worked on San Pietro Montorio, remember that pier I told you to remember? Look at the red infill, which are the structural elements of this plan and the structure. And look at this diagram below, which is basically this idea of different centralized and Greek cross plans, which also can be found in some early Christian and Byzantine churches like St. Mark's of Venice. This is a way to sort of understand structural base systems and a kind of spatial disposition of the nave and side aisles and transept being incorporated into a kind of centralized organization, which was, of course, an aspiration for architects, including Bramante in the Renaissance. And we see this famous parchment plan, which is only drawn half, right? It's only half a drawing, because it's implied that the rest of the project will be repeated in symmetry. And from this plan, other architects, when Bramante dies, including Raphael, who was a student, Peruzzi, and then finally Michelangelo, will look at this plan and try to sort of work off of it, work with it, change it, develop it, make it better, make it worse, expand it, contract it. Michelangelo, however, we can say, did a great job, and we'll see how, of synthesizing the goals of this plan and also improving on it by unifying elements of it, which don't seem so unified. So let's look at this story of this last building. So again, it's this idealized, perfect church. Again, this centralized church instead of a small, tiny chapel on a hill, it becomes the center of Christendom. So it's important for its symbolism and its scale. And we understand that, you know, the piers, these two piers, are the piers that are going to support the dome later. They look kind of small, especially when we see the scale of the piers at the apse of the altar. And so the structure here, while it looks quite beautiful for many reasons, one is that Bramante is using that trick that he used in the early St. Peter's, which is that you use this infill rubble structure, and then you shape the space by casting in stucco the needed axial ends and apses to allow classical architecture to define this kind of centralized bays and connect them along these cross axes, the larger scale and then the smaller buttressing corner bays, to create a kind of sculptural possibility for the shaping of interior space. That's kind of the big contribution, that the two big contributions that this plan makes. However, from a structural point of view, these members are very thin. That's maybe a great sort of visual ambition, but practically speaking, there needs to be more structure to support the weight of all this structure above this plan, okay? And so the new focus in this plan is on void and space and walls. Space takes on this kind of molded sculptural quality, being a series of voids, and there's this kind of dynamic expansion between these different spatial units and modules that we see in the diagrams on the left. And the war, what happens is that the walls and piers seem to be carved or hollowed out as opposed to built up and additive. Okay, so here's a kind of development of that plan as a full plan. And from that plan, and from this commemorative coin, remember we saw the commemorative medal that from one of Alberti's churches, the idea of the facade can be understood. And now, as brilliant as Bramante was, trying to adapt this classical architectural system without having any precedents to back it up, to, you know, he had to invent a new system. You know, the outside looks a little bit more aggregated, additive, sort of collaged, different buildings put together, as opposed to kind of singular, unified expression of one building that the dome is attempting to cap. Right? This almost feels like there's a village, you know, supporting this dome space. It doesn't feel like this is one building, and so that's kind of a negative in terms of what the goals of the design were. But so we see, and I'm not going to explain it all, but you can see the effect, right? You can see the effect that doesn't quite bring this into unity in the same way that the plan attempts to. And so many architects after Bramante's death, including Raphael, who's his assistant, and Bramante working with Peruzzi before his death, and Sangallo later on, who tries to make the plan more longitudinal because the church wants to have a nave, and then finally Michelangelo's plan. It's these two plans we should be looking at, even though, and looking at how that plan finds its kind of full development in this kind of Roman language, in this kind of complete and unified sort of vocabulary that we saw that Bramante attempted to develop in his other buildings. And we see also an earlier plan after Raphael. Raphael also died very young in his, I think he was not even in his 30s or 40s, he didn't reach 40 or was around 40. And we see both this kind of, remember it takes a long time to build in this time, it's a huge building, and we see the ruins of the old St. Peter and the construction of the new St. Peter simultaneously taking place. I'm gonna let, John, do you talk about the School of Athens? Oh, I'm gonna do that, okay, so I'm gonna do the School of Athens. Okay. So we see the School of Athens, which is a painting painted, one of the frescoes painted by Raphael, which is probably the most famous one because, one, it relates to what we're talking about in that it depicts this scene, which seems to be what the new St. Peter's will be looking like. But at this time, we can see, even in this painting, this building is incomplete. You can see sky above, very much like the building site of the new St. Peter's being built around the old St. Peter's. But it depicts this kind of story of intellectuals. The two at the middle, the two people at the middle, you can see better than I can, are Plato and Aristotle. Plato's hand is pointing up, and Aristotle's hand is pointing forward, which depicts the two classical Greek philosophers' ideas about thought and about science. the ideal, that things are made from perfect ideas, as opposed to Aristotle, whose ideas are about using science empirically and understanding the world through experimentation. And the sort of union of those two philosophies along the center line of the painting, framed by the arch of the church and these kind of spherical pendentives, and all the other important Roman and Greek scholars there's a painting with a legend on it. I think we referred to it on our website, as well as depicting Raphael respects Michelangelo so much that Michelangelo stands for the ideal artist in this painting. These are all sort of figures that stand for very important intellectual and scientific and artistic moments and ideals and sort of plateaus in Western culture. And Michelangelo, you know, is so respected by Raphael that he puts Michelangelo in there in his painting to depict the sort of image of the great artist who here is standing alone brooding over his sketches, right? But this is a very important painting because, one, it shows us Raphael as both painter and architect, who again was a student and an apprentice and also an assistant to Bramante, and then he also inherits most of his commissions before dying. And it shows us this kind of perspectival view, this kind of important, centralized, Romanized architectural space, right? The sort of new state of the art, the new state of the universe, the new worldview, depicted, again, in perspective, frame for the viewer, about a world that happens on earth, not in the heavens, this kind of worldly humanistic achievement, this catalog of these great minds and achievements in this painting. Now, there are other frescoes, and there's a whole story about the frescoes, and I think Ed might touch on that when he talks about Raphael and mannerism. But so here are some attempts by Sangallo, who also was Bramante's assistant, to try and take Bramante's idea, and because Sangallo is much more of a technical architect and less so than Michelangelo, who is both this kind of integrator of technique and expression, we see these very kind of stacked architectural towers, stacked architectural levels, taking this kind of very scholarly approach to how to organize and put together this kind of classical language in new ways, including topping them with these kind of mausoleums or tholos at the top. Not quite the same expression as we might have seen in other buildings by Bramante or others before him in terms of mastering that kind of language at a smaller scale. Okay, so, but Michelangelo finally gets this commission. I'll leave the story out. And what he says finally, after studying all of the other schemes, after studying Bramante's plan, he says, you know what? I was in error. Bramante was a genius. That plan is a genius. And, you know, this is rare in Michelangelo's life, but seeing how wise and how intelligent he was at the end, he also corrected his own mistakes and tried to, the best of his abilities, create a plan, again, embracing what was given to him, embracing the limits, embracing the dimensions of the plan that were already begun, try to sort of refine and integrate the intentions of Bramante's plan into probably a much more better unified, centralized church. We can see this kind of diamond-shaped plan with these kind of spurs sticking out which integrate the overlap of a square and a Greek cross plan into a kind of a circular, centralized overall image, simplifying the space of the church into a main nave and transept with these kind of secondary corner chapels that also then beef up the walls, use the same idea of the sculpted poche space of the structure, thickening it up where necessary, not necessarily undermining the sculptural, spatial, and sort of open, unifying quality of the cruciform and square plan, and creates this very compact and sort of elegant solution to the plan, as well as an entry and staircase that is simply an extension of one of the sides, slightly different than the apse and the transept apses. And we see how it's much closer than any of the other plans at trying to retain Bramante's intentions. And we see how he's kind of fused this area into much more simple areas so that there's a hierarchy between the central axis and the sort of side aisle, so to speak. And we also see a much more simplified, in a sort of positive sense, simplified in a complex way, compression of this building into a kind of base and surmounting a centralized dome, which is a kind of support visually and also separated between the lower and the upper zones. We don't see towers and stacked architectural orders. We only see basically two levels, two sort of monumental but elegantly sculpturally defined elements, which form a kind of pyramid, right, which point towards the heavens. And we see a kind of use of very simple circular and rectangular geometries and very few but repetitive and expressive architectural elements. And I think this view tells it all. And it still also speaks to, I would say, that same intention of Bramante's sculpting of the pier on both the smaller St. Peter's and the larger one, but taken to the exterior of the building from Michelangelo's success at the Capitoline, where he uses the larger order as a kind of rhythmic element and supportive element, and the large entablature as a kind of unifying band. This path of the outside edge of the building, which has corner, diagonal, curve, diagonal, corner, diagonal, curve, right? That sort of bending in and out, which in plan bends, in elevation remains quite consistent and legible, and even in perspective, one sees that this building frames and supports the central dome inside and above. Very compact, very integrated, very, very ingenious way of compressing, while still using the same system he did at the Capitoline Hill, where the larger order, the giant order, leaves space for the smaller order of the tabernacle openings and balustrades, and the invented architecture, which counterpoints the classical Roman Corinthian or composite orders that we see in the capitals here. We see these two scales, and we see this kind of sculptural quality of also the play of the eye following the folds of the orders. Here, where there are changes between the major surfaces, Michelangelo bends and folds the column. Where it's on its outer edge, he retains it as a kind of singular, pure order, and at the corner, it becomes a three-dimensional corner. And even around the curve, it begins to sort of take the eye, and as you walk around the church, into this kind of dance or sculptural alternation between different conditions of inside, outside, corner, and curve. And ultimately, you know, here we see that it's extremely balanced in all the ways that I've described it, while still somehow projecting both this kind of horizontal base and this vertical aspirate dome. And also using this sort of invention by Brunelleschi of a double skin dome to make it lighter. It's important to look at this section just to see how simple also it expresses this kind of basilican section, but also structurally, the colonnade that's at the base of the drum of the dome, it was meant to have a series of columns as well as a series of heavy sculptures, big heavy sculptures, to be a kind of counterweight for the thrust of the weight of the dome. And here we see, you know, how long, you know, it took, and how the public space, which you'll see transformed next week when you see John's lecture on the Baroque, how the old St. Peter's slowly transformed into the new St. Peter's without a facade for quite a period of time. And we see the final version, which changes its profile. This is by Giacomo della Porta, because Michelangelo is dead. We see the absence of those statues I mentioned to add weight as a counterbalance and buttress to the thrust of the weight of the dome. But this higher dome and this kind of elongated dome, which is much more like the profile of Brunelleschi's dome in Florence, not like the original dome that Michelangelo designs, which is a perfect hemisphere, right? It changes the structural values, and so they have to actually put chains at the bottom, you know, like the chains that were described, the intelligent chains of Brunelleschi, this later addition of chains, cast iron chains at the base of the building, to hold it from expanding at the thrust, had to be added because of this modification of the profile of the dome by Della Porta, and then putting this the original design of Michelangelo's lantern at the top. And we finally see the interior, how, again, it sort of reminds us a little bit of Bramante's interiors in his first churches, right? Even the decoration, which is a mixture of Roman and also Michelangelo inventive ornament and pattern. And we see paintings done before the camera, and today, the photographs of the same space, how this pilgrimage church, the most important church in all of Christendom, really becomes this huge, very, just much like the Pantheon, right, which is one of the models for the dome and one of the models for all the domes of Christian churches. We see how the space works and how light is very much part of this white and gilded gold interior, and also how the Roman vocabulary is very well understood by Michelangelo and his colleagues. And later on, Carlo Maderno will add this facade, which is not the facade of facade designed by Michelangelo. It's the facade as well as the nave that's added, and you can see from this painting where Michelangelo's church ended and where the new nave was added to create this kind of Latin cross as opposed to Greek cross plan. And the final two slides are just to remind us of the influence of Michelangelo and how he leads forward not only to mannerism but to the Baroque. This is a gate called Porta Pia at one of the edges on the Via Pia, which is a kind of celebratory gate along what was at one time a very affluent street with palazzos on it. But as we saw in the, especially in the new sacristy, what is this thing? Michelangelo's doing the same thing where he's creating these kinds of center, and the facade is basically, could be a church, right? It's got a high nave and it's got side aisles, but it really has the battlements of a kind of protective wall and brick, right? But the architecture and the sculpture, which are more of the architectural orders, are all invented. They are in no way anymore a resemblance of Roman or Greek architecture, except perhaps this capital. Michelangelo here, as we can see from his paper drawings, where he's actually drawing different ideas simultaneously, one on top of the other, and also trying to save paper at the same time, gives himself different possibilities for inventing and solving different combinations of new invented and illogical, I would say classically illogical, but very Michelangelo-esque inventions of architectural elements. That's important because it leads to a huge debate. There are the architects who don't believe that this is the way that classical architecture should go, and we shouldn't look at Michelangelo as an example because only he could do this. And then there are other architects who say, wait, this is great. Michelangelo has liberated us. Architecture has a new direction. And the last slide I'll show you is the Sforza Chapel, which is in the Santa Maria Maggiore, which is a very important, one of the seven important churches of Rome, pilgrimage churches. And we see this plan, which is very interesting, where Michelangelo does a few things. He changes the orientation of this little chapel, right? Instead of it being longitudinal, the side aisle becomes very important. It gets this kind of important inflated, inflexed wall, which sort of expands its importance and its sort of dynamic visual spatial orientation. It thrusts these four columns at a diagonal to support this kind of vaulted area, which is somewhere between a dome and a spherical pendentive, right? It's a dome, but somehow absorbs the spherical pendentive into it, and the column becomes the base for these four different arches that are somehow supported by this diagonal space. And the columns, the arches, and the sort of direction of the geometry of the space is towards more of a kind of elliptical, elongated, stretched architecture. And these two projects really lead the way and inspire many other architects who will be developing both mannerism and then Baroque tendencies in architecture in your following lectures. So I thank you for your time and see you next semester.